Okay, thank you. So, hello everyone. My name is Jan, and I'm a student at the University of Technology in Brno. And together with my supervisor, Vladimir, we wrote a paper about the quality control methodology for simulation models that we use for our computer network protocol models. Okay, so the quality of the simulation always depends on the quality of the models themselves, especially on their ability to reflect the behavior of real-world systems. So in our paper, we are basically dealing with our experience with the testing over the years, especially on computer networking models, and especially routing protocols. So I would like to give a brief introduction into the work that we do. So what is a networking protocol as we think about it? Well, it's a syntax and semantics of messages. In other words, it's basically a set of rules that we use for sharing the state between the different parties. Any protocol can be formally described by finite state machines, for example, that is very popular, or temporal logic. Finite state machines are way more popular because they don't require any official background in maths or something like that. So finite state machines are way more popular, easier to understand, and you can see them even in RFCs. So for example, here are some finite state machines, and each transition basically corresponds to some event that happened on the device, and each of these events can also lead to another event. So for example, if some device receives some message, it responds to this different message, and it transfers to different state. So here are just some examples, for example, TCP, finite state machine, and BGP, finite state machine. Okay. When we are doing the implementation of our protocols, we are trying to follow some standards. That means it's basically some RFC or some IEEE standard. The problem is that the standard usually covers only the main part of the protocol behavior, which means that there are usually some edge cases that we have to deal with in the implementations themselves. This basically creates a diversion between our implementation and different ones. So we are also recognizing some different protocol designs that we come across. For example, the protocols with hard-coded stuff, that's the best example for this type of protocol is OSPF-V2, because OSPF-V2 had to be completely rewritten and released for IPv6. So this is what we would consider a bad design for a protocol. A much better approach is the extensible design, which uses some type of TLV fields, which are then used to extend the functionality. This is, for example, BGP, ARGRP, or TCP. And if you can see the picture down here, this is, for example, IPv6, which uses extension headers. And this way, you can basically, if you want to add some functionality, you can basically release a standard that would add extension header. And then everyone can understand that if they don't support this header, they can just skip it. And if they do, they can just parse it. So this is the way that you add a functionality to even old protocols. Okay, so when we are actually comparing the protocol models, we have to use something as our referential implementation. So the first thing that you may already know is Cisco Packet Tracer. Cisco Packet Tracer is a simulator created by Cisco, and it is mostly used for Netacket like ecosystem, which basically means that it is used for the students to learn some basics about network protocols. Cisco Packet Tracer generally has very limited functionality. A lot of the functionality that you would find on real devices is missing. And also the messages that are generated by Packet Tracer are sometimes not correct according to some RFCs. So this is something that we would not use, but we recognize that it exists, and maybe for some like not very complex protocols, it would be okay. On the opposite side of the spectrum is the physical device. This means that you would actually use the real physical device for the comparison, but basically you have to pick some vendor and you would get only the vendor specific functionality. And this is very expensive way to do testing against, because if you, for example, create a topology with 100 or even thousands of routers, you have to basically go and buy all of these devices. So this is very expensive and very inconvenient, of course. So the best thing that that we use is emulators, which means basically GNS3 or FNG. These emulators basically virtualize hardware for real images, so that the real image has the same functionality as the physical device. And with this, you can even run big topologies, and it all depends on the CPU power of your system. So I would like to show you some of these tools, if that's okay with you. So this is the latest version of Cisco Packet Tracer, for example. And I would like to just show you some quick example. So it's drag and drop, basically. I can connect two routers together, and then I can use either a virtual, graphical interface to configure them, or I can use this simulated console, which has most of the commands that you would find on real devices. So for example, if I do some configuration real quick. So what I did is that I edit IP address to a interface, and I can do the same thing on the other device. So what I can actually do now is I can use a ping command, and I can ping from one side to the other. So this is very similar to how would a real device operate, but because this is a simulator, what you can do is you can switch to discrete time. And now you can also inspect each message. So for example, if I do the ping command again, what you can see is that a message was created here, but nothing happens until I just until I ran the simulation. Yeah, and I can observe this, these messages like this. So I can even like inspect the message and look through some information. But yeah, so this is a Cisco Packet Tracer, for example, the tool that we would not use generally because it is very limited in functionality, but it works somehow. And if you have some easy to understand protocol, maybe this would be maybe good thing to use. So the I would like to show you our emulator actually. So this is EFNG internet emulator, and how it works, it is running on our server, and what you can do is you can access it through your browser anywhere, and you can build the topology similarly as you would do on the packet tracer, and then you can actually again run the same commands here. But because this is not a simulator, there is no way you can actually stop the time and look through messages and stuff like that. So the way that we actually capture the traffic is that we use Wireshark that we connect to a given link, and now we actually can capture the traffic on a given link in real time. So if I go back and I do the ping again, I can see that I captured a lot of ICMP messages, which I can now inspect as you would do with normal Wireshark traffic. So I can see basically every byte I can inspect. And all of this is just as a real device would generate. So this is a very powerful thing to use. It's very easy. And only thing that you have to keep in mind is that this is running on your server, so you have to keep your resources in mind. So sometimes what can happen is that if you are running a big topology, your routers would shut down because they would run out of resources or stuff like that. So, but yeah, this is very powerful and useful tool that we use. So let me go back to my presentation. Okay. Okay, so this is all what all we already went through, Cisco Packet Tracer. Yeah, just some interesting things you can do with Packet Tracer. You can actually connect multiple instances of Packet Tracer together. This is GNS3 emulator, and this is the tool that I just showed you. This is EFNG. Another thing that I forgot to mention is that you actually need the image itself. So sometimes there is a big big list to choose from when you are actually picking up the images. So that is another thing that you have to do, is that you have to do your research to actually know which image you want to use, because sometimes there are some bugs or some functionalities that are limited to certain images. So you have to also do the research on that. Okay, so now I would like to talk about some challenges that we face when we are implementing our models. So the first level that we usually face with most protocols is the level of accuracy. The problem is that some protocols can be very complex. For example, this is RTP, and you can end up with some finite machines that look like this. And this gets even worse when you think about the fact that RTP uses SIP protocol for signalization. And this gets really hard to debug or you know, to fix stuff in, because it's just so complex. And the question is what functionality you can actually omit and not implement, because you can use the time that you would use to implement such a thing to basically improve other things. So the question is, what can we omit? Another challenge that we usually face is the application of cryptography. So cryptography usually, you know, like always guarantees confidentiality, integrity, and authentication. So that means that our messages cannot be inspected by anyone else. They cannot tamper with our message, and we actually know who sent it. Well, if we decide to implement the cryptography, we are getting closer to the real protocol. So that is the main benefit. We are also able to, if you are doing some hardware in the loop simulations, you basically have to implement some cryptography. But this brings a big list of downsides. Well, the main problem is that you don't actually need cryptography unless you are doing hardware in the loop, because you usually know if your topology or your models actually guarantee authenticity, integrity, and confidentiality. So you don't actually need any of these. Another like big downside is that if you actually decide to implement cryptography, you would actually usually use some type of external libraries such as OpenSSL. The problem is if you decide to use such a library, then you have to somehow include it with your model, and the model expands. And if you decide not to include such a library, then you have to implement it yourself. And another like big downside is that you are actually wasting CPU time and memory each time that you have to do encryption and decryption. So the question is, we should include or exclude cryptography. And the way that we usually, for example, deal with this thing is that we just use a magic string that would say this message is encrypted. So that is how we would use it, because we are actually not quite fond of these downsides. Another challenge that we are usually facing is the problem of timings. Well, the better reference implementations that I've shown you, like the real devices and the emulators, are running in real time, while the simulation is discrete. So we had to somehow synchronize the real devices. So we would have to configure some protocols like NTP or P2P to synchronize our clocks on our real devices. And when we would actually want to execute some events, we would use Scenario Manager for Omnet++. But on for real device, we would have to. Okay, we would have to use something like EEM or TCL scripts for Cisco devices to actually execute some sort of events. So the question is, what tools are we going to use to guarantee timings? And the problem is that you have to choose some tools, actually, because if you want to actually execute some scenarios, you would actually have to deal with this thing. And the last challenge that we face is the randomness that is introduced. Well, when you think about it, the real devices are running on real processors, which means they are usually switching contexts between multiple processes, which introduces a degree of randomness which always impacts reproducibility and readability also. And it also reduces inconsistent race conditions. So what you would observe are some stochastic delays. That means that basically there would be some random delays. Even if you run the same scenario two times, you would see different timings, basically because the device is, for example, occupied with other process. So you have to keep that in mind. And also, also devices usually try to introduce some form of jitter between messages to avoid potential racing conditions between protocol instances. And this also helps with a stable bandwidth consumption. So the protocol messages have non-standard gaps between them. So you also have to consider that these things are happening. Okay, so the goal of our paper is to define a structured way for a validation and verification process that anyone can use as a guide for quality control of simulation models. We based this paper on our experience with the development and testing, and each step is based on all previous mentioned observations. Okay. So this is the methodology that we use right now and that we propose. So we have six steps. In the first step, we would actually choose reference implementation, which means Cisco packet tracer, real device, or emulator. Then we would build a topology. We would then basically execute our scenarios and capture all the traffic that we need. And then we would do a comparison. And then, depending on the results, we would have to revisit the implementation and maybe improve some stuff. This means that we usually, because we change some things, that we have to go back to baseline production, or at least comparison, to again generate pickup files and all the baselines, and so that we can do comparison again. So this usually takes a few iterations at least. And then if we are satisfied with the results, we can proceed with our package, reproduction package. I will talk about it a little later. So we start with our reference implementation. We have to decide on the way that we want to do it, and we also want to choose a vendor. Then we would build a testing topology. We recommend building a topology of the smallest possible size. You are basically looking at isolated like events, and you don't have to deal with a large number of traffic that is going in and out of the devices. And this is also important to keep parameters, typically protocol settings, interface configs, IP subnetting constant across simulation and reference configuration. So that is another thing to keep in mind. Then we can proceed with baseline production. So in this stage, we are actually creating our, especially our pickup files and our simulation files. So with the pickup files, it's pretty straightforward. We will just filter the traffic that are we interested in, and we would save them as pickup files. We are also, on the real devices, we are also using show and debug commands that will show us the changes to, for example, data structures or finite state machines of the protocols themselves. And also syslog messages can be useful. All of these things have to be always accompanied with timestamps. When we are done with our baseline production, we move to comparison itself. We recognize two different levels for comparison. So the first level is the protocol level, when we are looking on the messages themselves that are being exchanged by the protocols. So what we would do is that we would we would look through each message and we would compare it to its equivalent in the simulation. And we are looking at both syntax and semantics of the messages, of course. Another level is abstract data structure level. This means that we are focusing on data, on changes to data structures on the devices. So for example, we would monitor routing table, interface table, or topology table for ARGRP, BGP table for BGP, and so on. So, and also, you have to conduct this testing repeatedly on the, with different scenarios. And the best thing to do is to actually do the multiple runs of this of this testing. So you would use multiple topologies, multiple scenarios, and multiple configurations. So you would actually get the best results. When we are done with our comparison, we can go ahead and revisit the implementation, maybe fix some stuff or improve something. In the best case, the quality would even exceed original expectations, of course. And in the end, we would create validation and verification reproduction package. And this package would then be used by others to either verify our results or to create some sort of baseline for their experiments. This what I mean by that is that if I create some PCAP files which are originated on real devices, anyone can also use these same PCAP files that I generated for additional testing. Which means that if anyone is to like change something or implement something, he can use the old PCAP files. He does not have to go ahead and generate his own. He can use the ones that are all already present if they are done good enough. So now there is a short demonstration for this methodology in action. So this is phase one and phase two. So we have built this topology on Cisco devices. We also designed two scenarios that we would like to test. So here is the baseline prediction. So we would go ahead and capture traffic in Parashar. We would also run our simulations. Then we would go ahead with the comparison. So for example, here we are comparing some hello messages of ARGRP. So as you can see, some things are different. We would actually inspect those things and go ahead and fix them in the future. So yeah, this is a query message or something. Okay. Another, like the most complex thing you can do is something like this. If you run the simulation and the real topology, you would actually see that usually it deviates from each other. So there is a difference, like always. And what you can do to counteract this is you can use something like this, which is a table which has the corresponding messages on the same row. So you would basically match messages from the simulation with the messages from the real topology. And this would help you to actually isolate maybe some problem that exists in your implementation, or maybe you would actually find out that this deviation was just caused by some unlucky timing that was present on the real device. Okay, this is abstract data structure comparison. Yeah, this is pretty straightforward. You would just For example, at the start of the simulation, you would take a look at the data structures, and also in the end, and you would compare these two if they are actually the same. And this is it. I just want to mention that we actually created a demonstration of this methodology on our wiki page. And this page is also a reference in the end of our paper. So if you are interested in like more detailed look into this, you can go ahead and visit our wiki page. So I think this is it from my side. So I would like to know if you have any questions whatsoever.
Thank you for the presentation. It's very interesting, and I would say it's a very complicated process.
Yeah, I would say it's very time consuming.
Yes, I can imagine.
Yeah.
I mean, comparing this kind of comparison is never easy, and it's not easy to automate.
Yeah. It's very, very difficult, especially because of the randomness. On the real devices, you basically cannot do any like automated comparisons.
So one of my questions is regarding this thing, especially. I mean, did you actually notice change in behavior between the emulator and the simulation due to this, let's say, timing randomness? That sometimes not only just the timing changes, but the actual behavior, I mean, the messages, the different messages are exchanged because of timing or something.
Yeah, exactly. This is, for example, here.
I don't mean that the messages are different. Sorry, I don't mean the messages are different between the simulation and the emulation, but when you run the emulator several times, sometimes it might happen that it is doing something almost like it's not completely different, but it's not even the same that it did before in terms of the sequence of messages.
That actually happens quite often, more than you would expect. Sometimes it's not about that the message is, for example, delayed by something, but sometimes because the global order of the message is completely different, sometimes completely like new messages that you would not even expect would be generated. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that happens all the time. And this is why something like this is actually important, because you can use, you basically have to use your knowledge of the protocol to actually understand.
They are doing the same thing, just a little bit different.
Yeah, exactly. Uh-huh. In the best case, you would find that they are doing the same thing. Maybe one message was a little bit delayed, which caused maybe other message to be generated on completely different interface. That happens quite often, but.
My other remark is somewhat related to this, is that it's not worth working too much on that the simulation and the emulation should be exactly the same, because you would, I mean, it doesn't, if they are not exactly the same, it doesn't necessarily mean that the simulation is wrong in terms of implementing the functionality that is in the standard or in the RFC. Because the emulation is just some vendor-specific implementation of the RFC, so there could be reasonable differences, which doesn't mean that the implementation is wrong. Is that right? I mean,
I think I had some slide about this. Yeah. Vendors usually implement some, some two implementations of the same like standard can be different, especially if some of the vendors, if the vendor is Cisco, there can be
some special cases. Yes. They treat themselves better or something.
That happens.
Another question regarding the emulator. Do you have any idea that how does it scale in terms of the network size? I mean, just wondering, compared to the simulation. So if you have like, I don't know, 100 routers, does it scale as good as the simulation or?
Yeah, it's a shame that Vladimir isn't actually here, because he is running this emulator. He's running on server that he's managing actually. Uh-huh. And I think there was some like view that I could show you, but I'm not actually.
I hope they don't scale as good as the simulation.
Yeah,
definitely
worse when you think about it. There is each of these routers, unless you just go ahead and turn off a lot of things, they are basically running as they would when you bought them. So there is a lot of things that you actually don't need. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is happening.
But you don't have any numbers in your head.
No. I think we were able to run basically hundreds of these like virtualized on our system before they would actually start to shut down. But that is also maybe caused by the emulator itself, because when we would actually inspect the CPU usage, we would see that there is a lot of free CPU time, there is a lot of memory, but our devices would start to fail. so maybe there is something bad with the emulator itself. So that is something to consider. But generally, I think topology with hundreds of nodes is still okay for the emulation. But I would definitely agree that it scales much worse than simulation.
At least that's true.
At least that's what I think. I think Vladimir would give you better insight into this kind of problem, actually.
It's difficult, this kind of formulations. So you're talking about.
Oh, okay. This is what I was looking for. Yeah. It, for example, this is EFNG, and it allows you to view the usage of the server.
And how many nodes we are running right now? These are the IOL nodes.
I mean, this is just this my method. Simulation because it's available to basically every student on in our specialization. There is a bigger number of nodes. This is just one one lab that I created.
It's quite actually, at least it seems to me.
So I think that at least 100 nodes are running at the moment. So
I guess this is a large server.
Yeah.
Other questions.
Okay, if that's all, I think next session is starting in a few minutes. Is it right?
Yeah.